What's not to love? What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are. Church, your turn, sing with us. We will sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
You are the love.
You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning, Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name
of Jesus.
All right, let's sing that again. We will sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
One more time.
Yes, we will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Amen. You can be seated for a few minutes. Again, it's good to see you here today. If you're here for the first time, you're our honored guest. We thank you so much for being with us in our first service today. We want you to do a couple things for us. Again, we want you to fill out the I Am Here cards in front of you. If you'll go ahead and pull those out, put your name and your address on that card and drop it in the bucket when it comes by in just a few minutes for our offering. We would appreciate that. We want to just know that you were here with us today in worship. We're just going to send you a little thank you in the mail for being with us today. And then also after the service, we want you to take a minute if you're here for the first time. And please go by the Life Center and meet Pastor Mac and his wife Leslie. They want to thank you personally for being with us today. And they'll have a gift for you as well. So thank you for being here. Ushers, if you would at this time, if you'll get ready to come down for our tithes and our offerings. And while they're coming, let's pray. Father, we praise you. We thank you for such a beautiful morning that you've given us to come together and to worship you. God, we just pray that you would just rain down your presence and your spirit among us today. Lord, and we also pray that you would take the tithes and the offerings and that you'd bless it and use it as you see fit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I was woken up this morning at 2 o'clock and just felt the need to share a small part of my testimony with y'all because of one of the songs we were singing. The next song we're singing is God Is On The Move, and I could have pick something that was current, that was going on, that God was moving, or a way that God was moving in my life right now, but I wanted to share with the ones that are going through something tough that you may not be able to see how he is moving right now. But when Trent was born, my oldest son, he's 16. When he was born, he had a heart murmur, and I was told that it would close up on its own. And at this time, I was not in church. I had been saved when I was a teenager, but I wasn't currently in church or serving the Lord or anything. I was just doing me. But I had my son, and like I said, he had a heart murmur, and they said it would close up. And after that, he had to go to the heart doctor every 6 months and every year. And they had told me that he would start going every 2 years after his next visit. Well, whenever I took him, I was supposed to take him in April of 2004, and he was 3 and a half, I think, or close to it. And so I called to find out when the appointment was, because it had been made the previous year. And they said, well, I don't have you on the books for this year. And I said, oh, okay, well, I'm pretty sure he was supposed to come. And the lady said, yeah, I remember Trent. He was supposed to come. So she went ahead and wrote me in. So I went for the appointment, and they checked me in. They did his vital signs and all that, and they sent another nurse back, and they were like, hey, you realize you weren't supposed to be here until, like, next year, right? And I was like, well, that was questionable, but I thought it was supposed to be this year. So she said, well, let me go see what the doctor wants to do. I said, well, that's fine, you know. Having an echocardiogram bill this year is going to be about the same as it is next year, so just go ahead and do what you need to do. So the nurse comes back and she says, okay, well, Dr. Trant said he'll go ahead and see him this year, and then it'll be every 2 years from then. So he comes in and he does the echo, and he's all quiet, and he's like, okay, well, I'll be right back. And I was like, oh, geez, that can't be good, you know. So he comes back and he says, well, there's a problem. And I was like, okay, well, I kind of already gathered that. And it was that one of the murmur that he had was actually getting larger instead of getting smaller. And so he said that he would need surgery within the next year to prevent the one chamber of his heart from working overtime and enlarging because it couldn't push all the blood out. So I was like, okay, well, so then what do I need to do? So I was like, schedule it and get it done. Whatever. And of course, Florence doesn't do this, so we had to go down to Charleston. And, you know, around this same time, I had a friend that had been inviting me to church, and I was like, you know, okay, yeah, I'll go with you. She worked with me, and so I finally took her up on our invitation because, you know, obviously this was like way bigger than I could handle. And so I went to church and with her, and, you know, I just decided I had to give the whole thing to the Lord. I actually had somebody come up the weekend before Trent had his surgery and was like, I don't know how you're so calm. And I was like, well, there's really nothing I can do. It's up to the Lord to work this out and the doctor's knowledge to, you know, fix this problem. And so we go down to Charleston and we get there and met with the doctor that would be doing the surgery in 30 minutes. And she said that they did the surgery. We met her, they did the surgery, and they came back and they said, well, I just want to let you know that that hole was actually bigger than what it was on the echocardiogram. So they had put a different plug in instead of a little mesh thing that spreads out to let the blood clot around it so that it would finish filling the wall. And so she was like, you know, he would have had only the 6 months before it started wearing on his heart and instead of the year. But, you know, at this point I was like, well, you know, that's a blessing. God's just worked this thing out. But this was the second surgery he had had. And they went in like a heart cath. It wasn't like they busted his chest open and all that. It was, you know, still major. But we actually went home that day. But so then, you know, I was into church, and this had gotten me back into church, and, you know, it definitely renewed my faith and that everything would be all right. And that was pretty much, looking back now, that's the first time that I recall my faith being so strong and just turning everything over to the Lord and being able to fully rely on Him and just know that everything was given his life to the Lord at age 9 during camp. So, you know, through all of this and the nerve-wracking situation of having your child have heart surgery and all that, the good thing is that he came to know the Lord and will live forever, not just continue to live from having his heart fixed here on earth. So I just wanted to share Isaiah 55:8 with you, which is, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord." And we don't know the scheme of the bigger plan, but we do know that everything that he does is for our good, even though we may not know it at the time. So I just wanted to offer that little bit of encouragement for those of you who may be going through something tough right now.
Amen, church. If you can, if you'll stand as we continue. Anytime a heart turns from darkness to light, anytime temptation comes and someone stands to fight, anytime somebody lives to serve and not be served, I know, I know, I know, I know, God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today. Anytime in weakness someone falls upon their knees, oh, there's a speed, the truth that sets men free. Anytime the choice is made to stand upon the word, I know.
Come on and lift your voice.
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today. I see a generation standing on the truth. In each and every nation, God is on the move. Anytime the gospel stirs a searching soul, and someone says, "Send me, here I go." I know, I know, I know, I know. God is on the move, on the move.
Sing that again.
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move.
Let's sing that one more time.
God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move in many mighty ways. God is on the move, on the move. Hallelujah. God is on the move today.
Let's pray and invite God's Spirit to be with us today. Lord, we praise you. We thank you again for all that you've done, and most importantly, for who you are. And God, we're in a season now of change and different things going on, and the enemies attacking in so many families, and discouragement just seems to be everywhere today. And Lord, I pray today, Lord, that you would lift our head and change our countenance. And God, remind us, if we're saved today, that we're children of a King that lives forever. And is you're in the business of changing people and changing hearts and changing situations. Lord, you're all about change. And God, I pray today that our hearts would be receptive to change. And our hearts would be receptive to your word. And God, that our ears would hear and our feet and our hands would do what you've called us to do. And Lord, I pray for anybody in this place today that doesn't know you in a personal, they don't have that relationship with you. God, I pray that your spirit would move, that you would fall on us today. God, that there would be no doubt that you are in this place. You've blessed us in so many ways, and we're grateful for that. We don't take that for granted, but God, we just need a great move of you. It's not about the programs and the preaching and the singing and the teaching and all that stuff. We want to lift you high. And we know if we do that, that you'll just make all these other things work out. So we honor you today. We praise you, God. Be with us today and change us to be more like you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear the heart of heaven beating. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. And the hush of mercy breathing. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Hear the host of angels sing. Glory to the newborn King, and the sounding joy repeating, Jesus saves. See the humblest hearts adore Him. Jesus saves, Jesus saves, and the wisest bow before Him. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. See the sky alive with praise, melting darkness in its place. There is life forevermore in Jesus' saves. He will live our sorrows. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. He will die our burden bearing. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. It is done, we'll shout the cross. Christ has paid redemption's cost. While the empty tomb's declaring, Jesus saves. Freedom's calling, sing it. Freedom's calling, chains are falling. Hope is dawning, bright and true. Day is breaking, night is quaking. God is making all. Sing that again. Freedom's calling, chains are falling, hope is dawning, bright and true. Day is breaking, night is quaking, God is making all things new. Jesus saves. Hold to pray. Rising up, rising up, so vast and strong, lifting up salvation's song. The redeemed will sing forever. Jesus saves. seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you all today. I'm glad you're here. If you want to look at God's Word this morning, let's get there to Luke chapter 16, and then let's give some type of explanation for this kind of title. Amen. It's good to see the Lamberts here. Amen. Good to see you. What in hell do we need? Now, I'm glad that I don't have people here who ever have their mind in the gutter and they think the worst. But it would be the same thing this morning as if we said, what in heaven do we need? What in hell do we need? There are some things in hell that the church needs. And we're going to look at 10 of those things this morning. And we're going to find those in, actually, this passage in Luke chapter 16. Who would have ever thought that we need something from hell to actually be in the church? So that if it was in the church, then we could get people turned around from headed toward hell and be headed to heaven. So if this morning you and I can find whatever it is in hell, now we've never been there and we hope to never go there. And we wish that on nobody, so we do what we do so that, number one, we can go to heaven, right? There's nobody here want to go to hell, right? But we got to look at it this morning so that we can help assure that we will not, and at the same time, be able to help people go to heaven. And so this morning, this question, this title is, what in hell do we need? And so we want to use that contextually. My daughter had asked the question the other day if this word was a bad word. And that's a whole nother story, but I will say that it's not a bad word if you use it the right way. But either way, if I were to wind up there or somebody was to wind up there that you know or love, then it would certainly be a bad word, because all our life growing up, perhaps you were like me in our home, it was always referred to as the bad place. Nobody wants to go to the bad place. But since then, I've learned there's other bad places other than hell. Amen. There's some shopping places in town that I consider a bad place. There's some places you can eat at around here that I consider a bad place. We don't want to go to the bad place, but then we do need to be more specific sometime. What is the bad place? Because there's a lot of those. But hell this morning, let's find out what it is in hell. Now, in this, some people say, well, this is just a parable, so it's not really a real story. It's not a real thing. Yeah, this is indeed a true story. See, what you've got to know is this guy today that we find out as God rolls back hell and he reveals it to us, this guy is still there. You know, the Bible was written a long time ago, but this guy is still in hell today. Those names that are on that cross up there, perhaps a lot of those, they're going to end up dying and going to this place. Unless we pray, unless we press, unless we do our job. I do believe this. Everybody in this room is responsible for so many different people making their way to heaven. They say that everybody impacts at least 10 people. There are some people you've got to know today, if you do not win them to Jesus, they will die and go to hell. If you don't win them. Some of them's your family. Some of them's your friends. Some of them are going to be complete strangers that you will run into at the right place at the right time, divinely set by God. And because of your preparation, because you knew what we needed in the church that hell already had, we could preserve them from actually going and spending eternity in such a place. I will tell you this. There are some people, if you do not win them, nobody else will, and they will die and go to hell. If you wait on the preacher, if you wait on the church, if you wait on the missionary, if you don't do it yourself, think about the people that are in your circle. You remember when you used to be bad? Or perhaps you don't have to think back too far, just think like right now. You remember all those friends you had around you that are no longer there anymore? Some way, somehow, you had influence on them. All right, those people could be won to Christ because of you. There ain't no preacher ever going to bust up in your old little circle and win anybody to Jesus. They don't want to hear from him. They don't want to see nothing about no church. All they think is he just wants my money. That's all they thinking. That's all they care about. And so my thing is, there's some people, I can tell you today, with the right kind of revival, you can win these people. But see, the thing is, you got to always remember this. You got to get yourself right. Right? Because if all you do is thinking about all your problems, you're never going to see theirs. So let's look at this and find out what is it in hell that we need today in the church. Let's look at this passage, chapter 16 of the book of Luke, and look at verse 19 together. And let's read it through. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day, which means he ate well every day. And there was a certain beggar in verse 20 named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of the sores. And desiring to be fed from the crumbs of that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by angels into Abraham's bosom, which means just into his presence. The rich man also died and was buried. Now, there is a distinction there. You notice where the angels actually just carry him who knows Christ, and the rich man is buried. Now, it doesn't mean that everybody who is buried here did not make it. But you do see this entourage of angels that are actually escorting them into the presence. Look on, it says in verse 24, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in your lifetime receivest good things and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all of this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, and neither can they pass to us that would come from thence or where you are at. Verse 27, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, because I have five brethren or five brothers, that he might testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. And Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let him hear them. And he said, Nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Now, number one, we want to notice that what is it in hell that we need in the church? Let's identify that we need God. See, the Bible teaches us, and I want to read this verse to you, and you have it, Psalms 139:8. If I ascend, David says, into heaven, thou art there. He says, if I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. He's saying that no matter where I go or what I do, you are with me. Now, we know going through Revelations on Wednesday night, there will come a time, there will be a second death, and it's a spiritual death after everything is said and done. And it says that that death is when God will actually separate himself from the presence of all those people in hell. But currently, God's presence and God's ability, he says, no matter what you're going through, I will be there. Now, we can see God in this passage because even though this man is really telling this story from the pit of hell, that he can actually identify that there is a God. And he's actually praying. Think about it a minute. Somebody who hates God cannot be an atheist because they cannot hate that which they do not believe exists. And so what is happening is he is actually now praying to God. He prays out or petitions to Father Abraham. But if you look at the passage here, this is before Christ has come and become the intercessor. So Father Abraham is like Christ is to us today. So we pray to the Father today, but we do that through Jesus Christ. He is actually praying unto God here through Abraham as an intercessor between man and God, saying, I am beseeching God. I am asking for God's help here. And so we need God in the church. Now, here's what's always sometimes I think assumed. Just because we dress up and go to church does not mean God is here. I mean, you can believe this. Most churches that will meet today will meet without God's presence because they did not gather in the name of him. You know what the Bible teaches us, where two or three or more gather in his name. And so a lot of people show up and show out today because they want to look good. Today is a social thing. They coming out today just to pay their penance or their duty or what they would feel like would be a reasonable service. And so people show up today in their own name. But, you know, who in the world was putting their buttons together this morning saying, I cannot wait to get before the feet of Jehovah today? Now, you're trying to think about how you're going to water and feed your animals before you leave. You up here trying to figure out how you're going to put your clothes on or what you're going to wear or what you're not going to wear. What you're going to eat before you even get here. And then you already thinking, like my children eating when we sitting at lunch, they want to know what we're eating for supper. And so we already thinking about all these other things, but who was it this morning that got up with a yearning this morning to say, I just cannot do anything else until I get before Almighty God because I want to worship and adore Him today. And so that is what you call coming and gathering in His name. And God wants us to do that. And so you can see in the pit of hell, there was a desire for the presence of God to show up and show out and do something for this man who is crying out to God. We need God of hell to be the God of the church. Number two, we have to look at the sinner. See, you see verse 22 and 23. Let's read that again. And it came to pass that the beggar died and he was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. So we know that he went to paradise. And it says the rich man also died and was buried. And look at verse 23. And in hell he lift up his eyes. So it is in hell that there are sinners. Now, you might say today, say, preacher, I got that covered. I am one. So there is plenty of sinners in the church. Now, here's what you always got to know. God considers you a saint. And I know you feel like you ain't. But you are a saint because of the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Man, if they were to tally up all our mess ups this past week and put it together, we would just fall off into a funky, depressing state. I mean, it would just be terrible. But what he's saying is you are covered with the blood. You died with Christ, and yet you live again. So what he's saying is, hey, you are a saint. But what we need in the church is to bring all the sinners. Do you know any sinners out there? All right, so we need to get those sinners and bring them into the church. See, hell has sinners. We need in church what hell has in it. We need to get the sinners to the church. It doesn't matter what they smell like, what they look like, what they're all about. We need to make sure that they're welcome, that we love on them just as much as we love on one another and make them feel welcome. And don't put on a front or be fake, but we need to say, hey, come on, everybody is welcome. We need God in the church like God is in hell. We need sinners in the church like we need the sinners not to be in hell. Let's look at the third one, a vision of heaven. Look at verse 23. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, but yet he seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. See, he had a vision. Now, you know that in this particular passage, and we've gone through this before, but very quickly, we're seeing a picture of what it was prior to Christ's coming. Remember, Christ has not died on the cross at this point. Christ has not been resurrected. So indeed, in the earth, in the spiritual world, there is a place called hell. And then it says that there's this big separation or a gulf or a valley, and then you have paradise. So this paradise is the same paradise that Jesus referred to when he was on the cross, when he said to the thief, he says, today you'll be in paradise with me. So now paradise is not heaven. But we know that all those who were in paradise have now been lifted from paradise and placed into heaven after the cross and the resurrection of Christ. But here in this passage, in the timeline, we see where there is a separation there between them. But what God has given to hell is a vision. Now, you've got to know that the rich man's not the only man that's in hell. There are a lot of other people in hell at this point, but he's the only one have been identified in this passage. But these people have the ability to see God's greatness from the place of damnation. How terrible would it be to be able to see what you could have? How terrible would it be to sit back and always be saying would have, could have, should have? It says that he had a vision of heaven from hell. Church, in our psychological evaluation, how much thought do you really give to heaven? In your day-to-day basis, see, as I have referred to it, as you have referred to it, man, this is hell on earth. But guys, we can deal with hell on earth if we have a vision of heaven. See, this man actually felt like he had hope in hell because he could see heaven. He could see what paradise actually was. And so what he's saying is from there is, I have a glimpse of heaven. Now in that, the church must too have the vision to be able to see heaven. What does Matthew teach us? That we should seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things would be added unto us. Seeking for it, looking for it, getting up in the morning time with your mind fixed on heaven, asking yourself this question, is the day today that Jesus will come? Is the day today that I will actually see the kingdom of heaven, that I will actually be with him. Instead of getting up and trying to plow through the misery of life and every day, yeah, we're going to have bad days, but I'm talking about every day you just get up. Maybe you done got in a rut and somebody told you you was in a groove. And so here you are in this rut and you're in this situation and you're up here and God says, just look up. Just look up. Stop looking through the life and through the hell and through the misery. He says, but I've given my people the ability and the vision to be able to see greater things. And so it's that vision of what lies before us instead of just being able to see what is in front of us that will help us as a church. We got to be able to see past these tough times. We got to be able to see the vision of heaven. They have it in hell. Do we have it at Lebanon? It will determine our attitude. It will determine our conduct. It will determine everything. Think about it for a minute. If in your mind all you see, and it's amazing what one decimal could do. But let's just say for a minute that in your bank account today that you have $1 to your name. Watch this, ready? You gonna eat differently today? You gonna dress differently today? You might not put as much toothpaste on your toothbrush today. There's a lot of different things. You might not go somewhere today you would have normally gone today because you know it's gonna cost gas money. See, it's going to determine what you look like, what you dress like, what you eat like, where you go, whether you're going straight home, whether you carpool, whether you roll with somebody. It is going to determine who you are, your character, your habits, your everything. But now, if in your bank account you got $10,000, all it is just some zeros on the right-hand side of the one. You're going to eat differently today. Amen? You're going to tell the lady put the whole pitcher of tea on the table. Man, just leave that. You don't have to take that with you. You're going to be so excited. You know, things is going to be there. You're going to look different. You're not going to be so stressed out. You're not going to be so worried. What he's saying is, If you look like you always uptight and stressed out, then you can write this on the wall. You're walking around as if you are about as broke as a joke as a Christian. See, you can walk through the fiery furnace with a smile on your face if you know the King is with you. See, you can plow through some of these places you've been in when you know something better is coming. And so a lot of the time, the demeanor of the people, the way you look in your face, you look like you broke as a joke. You look like you in hell now. This ain't hell. But yet we are people not headed to hell. We are a people that have been delivered from hell and on our way to heaven. We ought to look like it then. Well, the fourth thing is there was a sincere prayer, a specific and sincere prayer in verse 24. He says, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water. I always try to extract right there the point that he didn't say, bring me no cup. But he said, a drop. Now, this is a man who fared sumptuously every day. He had everything. I mean, he had appetizers. He had full course meals. I mean, he had dessert. He had coffee afterwards from Krispy Kreme. He had everything. You see what I'm saying? And yet he's a man now, just all of a sudden asking for just a drop of water. Notice the sincerity of his prayer. Notice how it has shaped his prayer life. Notice how he comes up and notice what he does in verse 24, and he cried. When's the last time you cried? Seriously, I ain't talking about when something dropped on your toe. I'm not talking about when your team lost, but I'm talking about when is the last time you just started pouring your heart out to God and you just broke right down in a cry? It's probably been way too long since that happened. Truth is, people need to get around to all the day and somebody need to smack them in the back of the head and make them cry. Amen? Give you something to pray about. Man, Lord, that hurts. You know? I mean, when's the last time you broke down and cried because you were so compassionate and so poor? Do you ever feel sometimes, this don't happen to me every time, but is there not sometimes when you pray that you just feel like your soul is connected to God, that you're just pouring it out of you? See, God wants you to spill yourself out so that he can clean you up. See, you can't keep all that in you. He says, pour it out on the floor. God wants you to spill it. And so what he's saying is, this man, can you imagine the desperation? What happens tonight when you close your eyes in sleep and when you wake up and when you thought you woke up, you wake up and you see a fire and then you realize just within a matter of moments through the shock and devastation, you in hell. You've been hearing all your life that they ain't no, this is a point of no return. You think you're going to pour out in one of the most sincere, specific prayers you ever had? Man, you're going to be praying your tail off, wishing to God you could do it one more time on the other side of the flame. And he's going to say, nope, ain't going to happen. You think that would revive you? See, he was praying a prayer. The sincere prayer, this is the kind of prayer in hell, church, that needs to be at Lebanon. That where people actually cry out to the Lord in compassion and passion, and they're pouring themselves out to God, they're just spilling it everywhere. That's the kind of prayer we need. Father Abraham, please let him come to me with just a drop. So thirsty. I'm so malnourished. I just thirst after something. God says, this kind of prayer needs to be in the church. Look at the fifth one. There is an awareness of how awful hell is. You know, sometimes, why is it that Jesus preached on hell a lot more than he preached on heaven? You know he did, don't you? He talked about hell three times as much in comparison that he did to heaven. Now, you would think he would be out there promoting heaven right and left. But, you know, I guess his strategy was if he promoted hell enough, you could just spend the rest of eternity learning what heaven was all about. He wouldn't have to teach you. He can teach you when you get there. So he was trying to warn people. So what the truth is, and we've heard this said before, sometimes we don't talk about hell enough in the church. Sometimes we don't talk about it enough in our conversation because we don't want to offend anybody. Truth is, when we tell the truth, we're going to offend people. If you're not offending anybody, you're not telling the truth. You're holding back. Now, I know you can push people away, but that's not what he's saying. We need to talk about it more. And it says here in verse 24, he says, when he cried out, he was praying for mercy. Means he was in a bad way. But then he says the tip of his finger was in water. And then he says that would he please come because I am tormented by this flame. See, you got anybody that you love today that you feel like might be headed here? See, that thing will shake you a little bit. See, what it might would do is where you was planning to go out today and just be a little lover and a pleasure of yourself, you're going to go out today and go take you a little joy ride, go out and get you a Mickey Mouse ice cream and just go over there and just get on the boat or go do your little thing, a little pleasure. You say you need a break. You had it so tough this week. Nobody ain't got it as bad as you. Go treat yourself. Spoil yourself. Go look out for number one. And then your mom and daddy's going to die and go to hell next week because you didn't do anything. Because you got it so tough. You got it so tough. But persistence in prayer and pressing on. See, God made a promise in that word that we got to hold him to. He said, when one gets saved in the household or in the immediate family, he said, I'll save them all. But he can't if you out there lollygagging, all worried about you. See, you shouldn't even be worried about you no more. You headed to the kingdom. You a child of the king. You're going to eat from his table. What you need to do is help get them sinners over there to the table where they can at least start eating crumbs. I think about a pound cake sometimes. You know the best part of a pound cake is the crumbs. It's that hard stuff that shakes off that thing in the bottom of the box that will make a dangerous meal with a glass of whole milk. Amen. Sometimes crumbs is good. It's all that other stuff in there. Amen, somebody? What I'm saying is we need to help these people out. We need to hook them up. We need to do something and not be so caught up about you. Man, what you need to do is just go over there and bust off into a third world country today and get yourself humble as pie and realize if you live in the worst trailer park in this America we live in, you live like kings compared to these people over there. And they happier than you are. Then people would not be able to stop smiling during this service. And some of you, I haven't yet to be able to see your teeth. Because you got it so bad. Man, them people over there, they got it so tough, it humbles you, church. But the thing is, we need to know that this place called hell is awful, and we don't want nobody going there. But you know what he told Peter and them? He says, you hold the keys to the kingdom. When you present the gospel, the doors open. When you be quiet about the gospel, the door stays closed. And we know nobody ain't going to get to the kingdom unless they understand and know the gospel. And the gospel is that Jesus Christ lived and died and lives again all because of them. We got to tell them the simple truth. And when you start opening your mouth, he says, I've left you the keys, my disciple. He says, just listen to the hinges. He said, because now the door's going to swing wide open, and this is going to enable them to be able to get into the kingdom. He says, but if you stay quiet, the door will stay closed. He says, but when you open your mouth, the door will open. He said, and you can enable them to get into the kingdom. Church, we need an awareness of how awful hell is in the church. We need to say it's an awful, terrible place, and we don't want nobody to go there. Look at number 6. There is a fire in hell. You imagine that? Now, I knew that one. It says that there's actually a fire there in hell. Look at verse 24, the last part. He says, I am tormented in this flame. Let me tell you about the flame real quick. One, there is a fire in the Bible that actually will cleanse people. See, what he's saying is there's a fire that what we do sometimes, we get a barrel, we burn trash. What we're doing is getting rid of our waste. We are cleansing our house. We are cleansing our garage. We are getting rid of something so we can make room for something else. There's a fire that actually cleanses. There's also a fire that calls. The fire that calls is like the fire that burnt on the burning bush on the backside of the farm for Moses. See, it did not consume the bush, but it actually was used to call and get the attention of Moses. There's also a fire, too, that will consume you. On the day of Pentecost, there was a fire that come down from heaven, as we've just reminded ourselves of. When it come down from heaven, it filled the people up, and it consumed them. See, what he's saying is we need fire in the church like there is fire in hell. There is a fire that will get the attention of a man. See, if you go home today and your house looks like it was when you left it, no big deal. You don't give it a whole lot of thought. But if there's a flame about 6 feet out top of the roof, it's going to get your attention. Your whole thought process just changed. See, fire can get your attention. And so in that respect, he says there needs to be fire in the church. There needs to be a fire that can cleanse you, that can call you, and that it can consume you. See, we need what's in hell today in the church so that we can help people avoid hell and make it to heaven. What in hell do we need? We need fire. Now, they say, where there is smoke, there is fire. Do you see any smoke in here? Look up at the lights. Most of the time, that's where you can see the smoke. Would you agree there's at least always smoke if there's even if you can't see the flame? Then we got to get the bellows out this morning, and we got to put some embers. They take those embers to a flame, and we got to. I was cooking on my big green egg the other day. That sucker would not take. And I leaned down over that grill, and I. Because you know preachers are full of hot air, right? And by that time, that thing said. I jumped back. Well, all I did was smell some. I'm telling you, you blow on it enough, it'll catch a flame. It'll get hot. And so what I want you to do is, hey, it might not. Maybe you cannot blow on yourself, but we need a wind from heaven in here. We need something to take those little bit of those little embers, and then they need to catch a flame again because there needs to be some smoke in the house. And see, we need God to help us with that today. Don't leave here without asking him to bring some fire from hell and put it in your church. I mean, wouldn't you rather feel the heat of it here and be headed to heaven than to say, I don't want it at all, and just get there and say, well, I'm going to just pull up a chair right there by myself. That's what the rich man did. And now he's there forever. Church, we need some fire. Look at the seventh one. We need to have a belief in what God says. See, our faith can get weak. Our faith can get low. Thank God that it only takes the faith of a mustard seed to move a mountain, because sometimes we'd be glad to muster up just enough faith for that. It says in verse 25, he says, but Abraham said, son, remember that thou in your lifetime received good things, and likewise Lazarus received evil things. But now he is comforted, and now you are tormented. What he was saying here was, you need to believe what God tells you. He says, you was told on earth. You were told in your life as we live today. He says, you are going to face judgment if you do not change. He's saying, God says it. See, and we got to relate this too in the church. Ready? We got to have a powerful belief that we must believe what God says, even if it doesn't look like it, even if it doesn't sound like it. We have a belief that if God said it in the Word, then we believe it to be true. And so what he's saying is, when God said he's with you, he's with you. When God said that he will never leave you, he'll never leave you. When God said, I'll never forsake you, he says, I'll never forsake you. God said, if I save you, I save you. God said, if I'm going to take care of you and I'm going to prosper you, I'm going to give you everything you need according to the riches in Christ, he says, then I'm going to do that. God has that because he said it and he settles it. We believe it. And what God is saying here is we need to have the same kind of belief that is in hell. That rich man is still laying there saying, that was the truth. I didn't believe it then, he said, but I believe it now. See, what God is saying is we need to have a belief in what God says to be true. In this place today, just like it is in hell. What in hell do we need? We need to believe like they believe. You imagine now that they're sitting there with the reality of that fire, do you think that those people really believe? Do you think they believe now? Do you believe that every atheist that thought there was not a God who sits in hell right now, do you think he believes there's a God? Do you believe that everybody who was told, listen here, you need to repent of your sins and you need to give your life to Christ, don't you think they believe right now? See, what it's saying is, ready? I know we believe, but sometimes our belief gets weak and it gets low. What he's saying is, for us to have revival, we need to have belief in church like there is in hell. Look at number 8. We got to have a burden for missions. Look at verse 27 and 28. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. See, now that he knows the reality of what God says is true, he knows he can't go. And you know, there's always been a question too there whether he's bound up or not, because he couldn't even reach out for the water. He just said, let the man drop it on my tongue. See, if I was hungry or thirsty, if he would just bring it to me, I'd get it. But when he says, let him drop it on my tongue, it must mean this man's hands are bound some type of way. He can't even reach for it. He can't do for himself. So he's crying out, and he has this burden here in hell for missions. He says in verse 28, for I have 5 brothers, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come to this place of torment. Here's what you need to understand right here. He's wanting a dead man to come back to life and to go to his brother's house and testify. See, what he's saying is here, there is a burden for missions for somebody to go tell somebody else about a place called hell and a place that we can escape if we would trust Jesus Christ. And he's saying, I have a burden for missions in my heart. That is in hell. Is it in here? Really? Do you burn inside with a burden to get that gospel out so people can get out of hell? There is a burden for missions in hell today, and you say, what in hell do we need? We need to have a burden for missions in other people. And if you notice, he says, I pray, Father Abraham. He's done broke off in another prayer. There's a lot of praying going on in hell, church. And he says, I pray. Now notice the compassion for a minute. You know the best thing for compassion is when somebody else's hurt is in your heart. He's saying, now I have a realization that I ain't getting out of this. He says, but would you please send him to go tell my brothers? Let me ask you. Are you sitting around waiting on somebody else to go do your job? What you waiting on, the women's auxiliary to go talk to your mama or your sister? Been a while since I come down here. Don't answer this out loud. Do you got somebody that's lost in your family? Do you got somebody that's lost in your family? Do you got somebody that's lost in your family? Do you got somebody that's lost in your family? Do you got somebody that's lost in your family? You got problems, I got problems. You got somebody that's lost in your family? What exactly is it you waiting on? And if you're waiting on something, a lot of the times when you get ready to get you a pen and a piece of paper to write it down, you can't find the words to write. Two reasons. One is because you don't have nothing to say, really. And number two, when you write it down, you start feeling guilty because what you are writing is not even worth writing because it's not even an excuse you're willing to accept. And yet they one heartbeat or one twinkling of an eye from going to hell. What are you doing still sitting here? See, we come to church so we can know how to be the church. It is nobody else's job but your job. I'm telling you, no matter how much time I would spend, now there's some people you know that, yes, I could win them only because of Christ. There's some people I know, yes, you could win them. But church, I'm here to tell you today, there's some people that only you can win. You have a relationship that has been established with them that I could never have. There's too many people and too much time that would have to be spent. You've got what it takes. What you need is just an encouragement from the Lord today. And the truth is, the revival that may break out in you will never happen if we sit in here for 3 months talking about it. But if you go out there and spend one day being about it, revival may break out in you. Because once you see what happened when you went out and applied God's word, and you lead them to Jesus, all of a sudden, the wind just blew, the fire just come ablaze. You tell me today what would happen if that somebody that's on your mind right now got saved the day before the sun went down. Would you not be running around doing some hooping and some hollering? Man, you would be fired up. You would have to tell somebody. Would you not? That excitement, it had been a long time since that happened. You hadn't never, you listen to me. You would be smiling so much, you would be like, it has been a long time since I have smiled or felt just like that. Amen? That's amazing. You know, it's, I was thinking about saying something corny, so I might as well say it. You would have smiles so big, you would say, there is 32 teeth in my head. And you never knew it. Amen? That is a lot of smiling right there, y'all. It is amazing. You would have such a joy. That might just be what it's going to take for you to have the revival that this Bible's talking about. A burden for missions. But what did he say? It starts in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria. Don't come up here today with this burden for missions. Say, yeah, man, we got to reach them over there in Spain. No, man, you done jumped to the uttermost part of the world. He says you got to have it in Jerusalem first. That's right here. If we don't take care of the people in our community, don't even think about taking care of somebody in another country. It starts at home. That's what he told us in Acts chapter 1. And then it works its way out. Don't come up here and say, I know what I'll do. I'm going to drop $5,000 on them over there in Brazil. No, man. Start spending 5 minutes here in Jerusalem first. That's what he's asking for. Look at number 9. There's a dependency on the Word of God for salvation. Look at verse 29. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them bear them. That's pretty harsh right there. A man over here who's in hell, he's saying, hey, would you please send Lazarus to my brothers? He said, hey, this man is just as sincere as he can possibly be. Abraham said unto him, he says, nah, ain't going to happen, Captain. He says, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father. No, Abraham. He says, if one went to them from the dead, he said, they'll repent. That's true. And to some degree, you let somebody come back like we talked about last week from the dead, and they pop up at your house. Amen? Boy, you're going to be like, uh-oh, I knew I should have went back to Sunday night service. He said, he says, verse 31, ready? Let's finish this. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Church, this is what we got to know. In hell, the rich man learned that there is greater power in the Word of God than there is somebody being raised from the dead and brought back to life. See, watch this grasping for a moment. We celebrate the resurrection, and we should, but we should celebrate the gospel of God more than we celebrate the resurrection of God. Because he said, it's not just that one can come back from the grave. He said, but it's one that can preach the gospel before they get there. He says, that has the most power. Now, ready, watch this here. See, what I'm going to end up doing is talking to one of my brothers or my sisters here in the church who has a sense of humor. And one day we need to come with their family knowing this here, and when their funeral is being performed in this church, what we need to do is try to stand over them, but don't preach their funeral, but we need to pray they'll raise up out the casket. Yeah, we'll just invite everybody in the church, so everybody come right down here and bring the oil. And what we're going to do is we're going to pray, because God said he was the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And we go pray for this person here. And maybe we'll even lay across them 3 times like Elijah did. They said, well, preacher, if you're going to be laying across somebody that died, it's going to be you by yourself. But we'll lay across them three times like Elijah did at the widow's house at Zarephath. And then we'll pray. And all of a sudden, I'll be hearing doors close behind me. Everybody's getting in the car. Y'all be gone. They gone. Preacher, just put it on Facebook. What happened? We'll believe anything you say there. That would wake you up. Because it woke them up. But if you would realize that the gospel that you already have, that you have liberty to always give, is more powerful and more amazing than somebody coming out of that casket, then you'll be revived. What did he tell the man? He said, listen, buddy. He said, listen to me, rich man. He says, he can raise him up. We can get him out of paradise and put him right back over there on your brother's front doorstep. He says, but you need to understand that what Moses and the prophets have in their possession is more powerful and more influential and has the ability to save far greater than a dead man coming back to life. And you got it in your hands today. That's strong. Now you say, well, Mac, people don't believe that. Yeah, but that's not the point. As long as God still approves it, that's all that matters. Because if he has sanctioned it and he's approved it, he's still got power to wake up a dead man walking in his sins. There has to be a dependency on that word. The last thing is eternity. See, go back to verse 26. See, they're in this conversation here, and there's a lot of things going on. And it says, and beside all of this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed. So that, basically he says in the next couple of lines, anybody but want to come from hell to heaven cannot. Anybody who wants to go from heaven to hell cannot. I'm going to give a real life example for a moment. I believe had not Josh and Alex and their family and Miss Amy prayed and God not allowed what happened to Bailey, I don't know that Bobby would be saved today sitting in this church. And I will use their family for an example for a minute. See, a God allowed what seemed like hell here on earth when the news came the day that baby girl was born. That was a very testing time of the faith, a very trying time as a man or a woman, a family. But see, that thing was already immersed in prayer long before that. And now that little baby girl is just as perfect as she can be. But God allowed that to happen so that Bobby could be saved. And now he has been saved. He has been baptized, and he is in this church every chance that he can possibly be here because he realizes where he used to be and where he's at and where he's headed. And he realizes that he had a family who loved him and supported him, and had they kept their silence like you keep your silence, had they give up like you've already give up, had they stopped praying like you've done stopped praying? Or maybe you'll shout out every now and then, God save them. But where's my Doritos? You don't really care. But when that happens, that happens. When that don't happen, that don't happen. Now, there are other stories in this church the same way. Now, don't get me wrong. God has made some of the people you trying to get saved a little bit more bullheaded and a little bit more thick-headed. But the good news is if you go home and drop them on their head to wake them up, you ain't going to hurt them. But what I am saying today is this guy found out that eternity is forever. And when he got there, there was no coming back. Number one today, we as God's people should be so overwhelmed with joy today that we did not die in the condition that we once were in, because we know today we would have wound up in the same place. Number two, we should be pressing so hard that these people who are headed there by God's word, not by our judgment, that we do something about it, that we pray, we press, we do something. And can I tell you today, if nothing stirs you beyond the amen and the final prayer of this service today, I hope that the Holy Spirit of God will bring to your remembrance soon what must be done. See, it's when you realize that what you've got is way too good for you to have it all by yourself, that's when you'll share it with other people. Now let's go back a minute. That dollar that you had earlier in the service, it's going to be hard to share that. They ain't even enough right now to smear around. But if you had 10,000 of them, you'd be more apt to share and to give. You know what all of this comes down to this morning in this revive us, and what in hell do we need? We have to understand today in the framework of this service that what we have been given has been given by God. It's also been given by God in such a measure that what you've got inside of you is enough to win the rest of humanity. And it rests in you. Let's stop playing games. And let's realize today that if you are in this church and under the sound of my voice right now, and you're not 100% sure that you will not go to heaven, if somebody pulls out in front of you on the way home and the last thing you were thinking was about dying today. Truth is, I don't give much thought in my life about dying anymore. But what I do give thought to now after the salvation of God is what it's going to look like when I get to live forever. See, when you've got God, you can look beyond death. You can look beyond what we call the end of the road. We can look into eternity and know that all is well with your soul. But do you believe that what you've got just for you? Then your actions should speak up. It should stand up. And it should deploy you that you go, and before the sun sets today, you make a call. There ain't nobody in here got no problem touching a phone. Touch it for the right reason. Touch it for something that will impact the kingdom. Because today we make a stand that we will seek ye first the kingdom of God and the righteousness of God, that all of these other things that we desire would be added unto us. Let's stand together.